So Tyrionyl carotomy is not based on the Tyrion. So when you make the Tyrionyl burhole, it is based on the Tyrion. The burhole is not at the Tyrion, that you must remember. Sometimes you say Tyrionyl carotomy, make the burhole on the Tyrion. The Tyrion is not the point. So when you tell your resident, because all of you are now seniors, you may be asking someone else to open the skull for you. So where to make that burhole? If you have to give instructions, how will you give that? You can't say make it on the Tyrion or something like that. So what will you tell your resident? What landmarks, bony landmarks are there when you do an tyrionotomy? There are three important bony landmarks. One is always visible, superior temporal line. Second is lateral margin of supraorbital rim. And third is where these two are meeting and with the frontal process diagmatic bone. So these three meet at a point. So this is the point, superior temporal line, the lateral margin of the supraorbital rim and the frontal process of the zygomatic bone. They are meeting here and about half a centimeter below inferior, that is the Tyrion. That is the where you make the key burhole, not the Tyrion. So when these three bones are meeting, half a centimeter posterior and inferior is where you make the key burhole. Now since we have talked so much about the key burhole, I'll just give you one more point, which I think is also time has come to talk about that. Nowadays almost everybody is using a drill. I mean, Giggly saw maybe some people, but most of the people have a drill and use it. When using a drill, then you have to modify according to your structure. So when you're doing a Tyrionyl carotomy using a drill, it's not necessary to make a burhole at the key burhole. It's not required, because what we do is we make a burhole like here. You make one burhole here, you come like this, come like this, then drill this part a little bit. So that is also acceptable, and it is come in textbooks also now. It's not necessary to have a key burhole always to make it. You have a drill, you are used to the drill, you make one burhole here, as you make the second burhole just behind it in the temporal area, frontotemporal junction. This bone cannot be cut with the V1 bit, this bone. So you can come like this, come up to here. When you're coming like this, you're coming the base, this will always be stuck here. Take it out, you can just rotate it, take it out. Use the AM8 or what, the terminologies keep on changing depending on the bits available. You drill this part, then you can break it. Okay. Coming back to this Tyrionyl again, there are two structures to protect when making a skin incision. One is superficial temporal artery and there is a facial nerve. Superficial temporal, you can palpate and plan your skin incision accordingly, because it can be variable. And sometimes, quite often, you can cut the superficial. It is always better you don't cut the main stem. It divides into two, a frontal and a parietal. You possibly will have to cut, sacrifice one branch when you're taking incision. But always try to be careful about the fact that you should not coagulate the main superficial temporal artery. Okay? The second is how to protect the facial nerve, the frontal branch which crosses around the mid of the zygoma. And because if you may do a grip craniotomy, sometimes patients have a little bit of drooping of this thing. This is not uncommon, this you have seen. So there are two ways to avoid injury to this facial nerve. One is you directly skin incision, you take it down to the muscle. Okay? You take it down to the muscle and raise the muscle along with everything, you will not damage the facial nerve at all. So this is one example. But sometimes you want a little more exposure at this base and you want to take a separate flap, skin flap separate and a muscle spur separate. So how to do that? As was classically described by Jasargil, always follow that principle. The temporal muscle has a superficial temporal fascia and a deep temporal fascia. The deep is on the deep surface of the temporal and superficial on superficial. The superficial temporal fascia in the anterior part of this frontotemporal area, in the anterior 1/4, splits into two and encloses a fat of pad, which is called the sickle-shaped superficial pad of fat. So once you are reflecting this, you are in the dissecting the loose areolar tissue. Loose areolar tissue we always dissect. The posterior part you keep on dissecting like that. When you come to anterior, cut that superficial temporal fascia, enter into the facial pad of fat. If this is a temporal muscle, the anterior 1/4 of the temporal muscle, in the anterior 25% of 1/4 of the temporal muscle, the superficial temporal fascia will split and that. So you in the anterior part of the incision, with your knife, you enter into this superficial temporal fascia and see the pad of fat and go below it. Because the superficial layer of the superficial temporal fascia will carry the facial nerve. In this way, you will avoid those things. Okay. So this was just what I wanted to add on to the this is standard Tyrionyl carotomy. These few points will help. I have learned this over years and years and years. So it's better to know beforehand why spend time in cutting and doing damage before you learn. So before coming to the craniotomies again, the positioning, everyone will be in a different place. And many times you ask your assistant to position and you come when the craniotomy is made. Till now, I will always like to be present when the position is made. I think I follow this principle. I will advise you also to follow it. When the position is made, after that you can go out and come back again if you're required. But when positioning is done, you always be there. One basic rule to follow when you are positioning patient supine, lateral, three-quarter prone, is you draw one line from external aorta like this. Okay, everyone knows this line from one external artery meters to there. A lesion is anterior to it, you can do in supine position. General basic rule: a lesion which is anterior to this line, you can do in a supine position. A lesion which is basically posterior, you have to modify your position, which can be if the lesion is posterior, which can be either prone, or sitting, or a semi-sitting, or a lateral. So these things you have to choose depending on your lesion. Now, whether you want to use a sitting or a prone or a lateral will be decided upon your preference and your experience. I have given up using three-quarter prone or parkway position most of the patients. The position should be simple because it is convenient to the patient, to the anesthetist, and to the surgeon. Just give an example: a CP angle tumor. So the positions described for a CP angle tumor are three. One is lateral or park bench position. Second is supine with the head turned to one side with the shoulder peg, and third is a sitting. So there is no right and wrong again. I personally do in a supine position because I think this is the most comfortable for the patient, with one pillow under the ipsilateral shoulder. Turn head only a little bit. When you turn in the head, you almost look at the sternomastoid muscle. Of course, it should not be too much flexed. If you flex it too much, you have ask the anesthetist to check the airway pressure. Don't turn it too much. If you turn it too much and the sternomastoid becomes taut, that means you may be putting some pressure on the veins. And most of you have good operating tables. You can turn the table. Why turn the patient when you turn the table with some support on this side? So this is a little bit about positioning. About retromastoid approach, in almost all CP angle tumors, unless it is a jugular foramen tumor extending into the C1, C2 area, you need not open the foramen magnum. It's not required. Unnecessary bone void is not required. You need not remove the foramen magnum rib. So what is required is when you are using a lazy S, the lazy S is starting above the pinna. This is the superior margin, just not above, just at that level of pinna, but one finger breadth or 2 cm behind that mastoid base. And when you are going inferiorly, you turn it medially. Why do you turn it medially? Just to avoid injuring the vertebral artery, one. And you can have a better exposure of the foramen magnum area. But you need not expose the foramen magnum rim completely to do that. Then third thing I wanted to add was, we have talked a lot and you must have seen so many skull-based approaches, anterior petrosal, posterior petrosal, orbitozygomatic, keyhole and everything. The skull-based approaches have also evolved. At present, I think posterior petrosectomy should be relegated to my historical archive. Most of the times, 99% of the times, you will not require to do a posterior petrosectomy to remove any tumor. So posterior petrosectomy, we have spent so many years learning how to do mobilization of the facial nerve, how to do the semicircular canals. But at present, I think most of the people who have done this also have left it. So you must be familiar with orbitozygomatic. Of course, has come to stay because it gives you better advantages. Orbitozygomatic, a standard retrosigmoid approach, and some variation of far lateral. This is enough. You need not go spend hours doing a lot of skull-based bony work. Okay. So just few tips, because this is my favorite approach, orbitozygomatic approach. I am quite fond of this approach. So I'll just tell you, and I do it in a single piece. So I'll just tell you how I do it. The orbitozygomatic is a good approach because it gives you a basal approach, and it can be used for complex anterior circulation aneurysms, for if you are operating once in a while upon posterior circulation aneurysms, and for the petroclavian region, because it allows the SS to look up into the brain without having to retract the brain. So that's very important. Without having to retract, you can look up. Orbitozygomatic can have very variations, but I will just tell you a standard orbitozygomatic. That involves exposure of the frontal region, the temporal region, orbit, and the zygomatic region. So the bones which you have to remove is frontal, temporal, part of the orbital roof, okay, across the zygoma here, and the root of the zygomatic process. I will just tell you in a single piece what bony cuts you have to make. Then depending on that, you can do your bony exposure. You have to make one cut here. The zygoma has two roots here. One is going here and one is going here. And the lower part is, you don't have to go here and open the temporomandibular joint. So this has to be cut here. This can be cut with a bit or a saw. Whatever it is, your choice. What are you? Or with a sagittal saw, just a giggly saw, or a cut. So this one cut has to be here. Other cut has to be across the zygoma. If you are too close to this area, you will fracture it here. How to know where to cut is, always look for the zygomaticofacial foramen. It is usually present in the center. This is the level where you should cut it. at the zygomatic of facial foramen. Sometimes there are two foramen, sometimes there are one, and most of the time there is a foramen available. And once you see one foramen, the superior most is the first one foramen is the one level where you should cut. So you should cut here. And third is, when you are here at the supraorbital notch, it's always possible, as Sanjay already told you, just do a little bit of drilling and take this nerve along with the periorbita. So what I do is make one burrhole here. One burrhole here. One cut here. One cut here. And stop. I don't and come here and this one little bit. I don't cut this thing here. Because I want to remove it as a single piece. So I do it as a single piece, it's just a variation. Your choice what you want to do. So from here to here and stop here. Then you have to carry this cut into the orbit. Okay? And you have cut here also. And the other cut is like this. So this is one cut here. Cannot be like this. And this you can use various ways of cutting this, always use a chisel and a hammer because that is the best way to avoid cutting the dura. If you use any power instrument, you can cut the dura here. Okay, I am not going to details of these things. And then you can just break it like this. So this was about orbitozygomatic. So this is lots of and talked about so many craniotomies and positioning. I'll just show you one more thing. Just you tell me now. How will you deal with this patient? This is nothing unusual about this. All of you see this. So, if you mark this tumor on this skull, how will you do it? You see, the first step before making craniotomy is to be exactly knowing where the tumor is on the skull. So, what are the landmarks we'll use to mark this tumor on the skull? This simple thing we say every day. What landmark will you use? Okay, one is you must know the coronal suture. Second landmark, parietal eminence. Okay, so one is you must know how far behind the coronal suture the lesion is. Parietal eminence. So you approximately know where the lesion is in relation to the coronal suture and parietal eminence. This is one thing. Second, midline. You must know in the look at the coronal images, how far from the coronal images. So one is sagittal image will tell you coronal suture, parietal eminence, where the lesion is. You can approximate idea of how many centimeters behind or in front of the parietal eminence coronal suture. Second is how far from the midline. Next, what is the third dimension? The third thing is you see you have to know how high from the base or how far from the midline it is. So how do you make out that? Which cuts will help you marking it on the skull? You know from the coronal suture, you know parietal eminence. So you must know above the orbital meter line how much high it is. So you look at the axial cuts, there are either usually they are 5 mm or 10 mm. You see the first cut, orbital meter cut, it at how many centimeters above the orbital meter cut the lesion has started appearing. So that you can do this the orbital canthometer line. Suppose it comes in the sixth cut and each cut is 1 centimeter. So from this cut, it is starting 6 centimeters above and ending about maybe 9 centimeters. This is a basic rule. I mean, all of us follow this, but we must know how to teach it to your students also. So these are things, coronal suture, parietal eminence, and how high above the orbital meter cut the lesion is starting. So this will help you making the lesion on the skull before you mark a craniotomy. Okay. So what craniotomy or what approach will you use for this? Orbitozygomatic. Okay. And what else? Orbitozygomatic with what? Additional anything? SCP drilling, because you want to decompress the optic nerve. The optic nerve is not involved, it is pushed to one side. So if you patient may have come to you only with vision loss and you do a tumor removal and vision doesn't improve, what's the fun? So that's why the drilling is important of the ACP. In this patient, orbitozygomatic with drilling of the optic canal so that you decompress and remove that. Now this, what issues will you have while planning the approach? What additional information would you add and how will you plan your approach for this patient? There is a vessel inside the tumor. So your concern should be this vessel. So you may do an angiogram also to know whether, and you have to know the, whether cavernous sinus IC is also involved or not. What craniotomy will you use for this? Or you want to do endoscopic? Different experienced people may be using different approaches. For example, if I have to do it, I will use a standard trionel with a little skull base work with a sphenoid ridge drilling. If there is extension of the orbital foramen, I will remove that also. And you have to be aware that it's not necessary that if there is a lesion in the cavernous sinus, just leave that. Not necessary to do a total excision. Sometimes it's better to be safe and you have to, you extradurally, this is a meningioma. So most of the supply will be from the extradural. So you devascularize that dura before you open it. Okay. You can devascularize that dura and the dural opening can be a little just on the tumor. So keep on removing the tumor till you get outside. So, tyrionyl craniotomy with sphenoid-rich drilling and possibly ACP drilling if required, depending on the extension of the foramen. Devascular the dura, open the dura, and keep on debulking the tumor till you become. Debulking the tumor is very important. Till it becomes smaller and smaller, smaller, then you have see around the arachnoid. Approach. I mean, we'll not discuss what this is or approach. You have seen so many approaches. So, you can come through the top, for endoscopic, and through the foramen monitor, you can enter into this terminal. Okay. Again, what's the problem in this? Simple, why am I showing you this? It's a simple thing. Anyone who has done his neurosurgery anywhere with the 2 years experience can do this thing. What problem can you have? And this looks very simple, nothing to worry about, everything. But still, sometimes you can have a problem with these lesions. Why? What surgical problems can you create which can cause a postoperative morbidity? This is a meningioma, but normally we don't have, I mean, you can have, of course, meningioma. There's edema around it, which is a little unusual. So, this edema can be usually because of what? Yeah, venous compression or pile breach, or sometimes we have secretory meningiomas. So, the problems you can have is, and sometimes in this region, you almost always have one vein on the anterior aspect, one on the posterior aspect. So, in this, what has happened? One of the veins has been coagulated. So, you have a post-op in edema. So, this increases the morbidity in the post-op period. So, as like any other tumor remain, the principle is do not coagulate any vein, and in meningioma especially, don't cross the arachnoid. You keep on debulking. At the end of the tumor, you should not be seeing normal brain. You should be seeing only arachnoid. At the base, you should be seeing arachnoid all around. You understand what I'm saying? So, this is what craniotomy will you use? Dark aneurysm. You see, this is a routine dark aneurysm. And many people, sometimes the people get lost while trying to find where the aneurysm is. You keep on searching whether you are proximal or distal, and you keep on dissecting and no aneurysm seen. What are the craniotomies available? Again, I am saying no right or wrong. What are the available craniotomies for this? What principles will you follow? So, what happens is sometimes if you are not careful, you make a craniotomy which is too posterior, too above the base. This is the skull base. See, somewhere here is the crista galli. So, this aneurysm, dark aneurysm, standard dark aneurysm which are at the genu, or almost always within 1 to 2 centimeters of the skull base. Okay. So, your craniotomy has to be a little basal. Whether you do a unilateral or bilateral is a personal choice. Some people do a bilateral basifrontal and then cut the crista galli, dura above the crista galli. Or some people use a unilateral parasagittal approach. But if you are too far behind, you will always be hitting somewhere here, then keep on searching here. And you come along the base, release the CSF first, so that you have a control. So, this what I want to say, dark aneurysms are not very distal, they are distal, but they are close to the skull base, almost always within 2 centimeters of the skull base. So, depending on that, you have to plan your craniotomy. Either you are unilateral or a bilateral, is again depending on what is your preference. It has to be just above the supraorbital margin, and then you go. Okay, this is just switching tracks approach. This patient has come to neurosurgeon because of paraparesis. So, that means obviously there is a spinal extension, paraparesis and posterior column signs. Approach. This was hydrated. I mean, we have now post-op histology also. Preoperatively, we consider hydrated as a possibility. This is a little unusual. So, the aim in hydrated is to remove it without spilling it. Otherwise, you have a lot of chaos. So, in what we did, we did a thoracotomy. And this was removed en toto. But during en toto removal, it looked that it may rupture. So, what the cardiac CT was just put a needle inside and without trying to spill. So, he felt that it's going to give a rupture inside the thoracic cavity. So, you can do a controlled without allowing spillage, that we done. And the same sitting, then we turned the patient prone and did a hemilectomy. It was external hemilectomy on that side. Okay, just switching tracks again. So, this is a MC infarct. What will you do for this? I'm already showing you what we have done. Decompressive. What precautions while doing a decompressive cramp? Many a time, all of us have seen, you have a small, you see why just large, what is called a trauma flap, all of you are not familiar. It is very important. It may look, but some stage is justified trauma flap for this type of thing. Otherwise, you have a chaos. Large trauma flap. This is smaller than what I would prefer for this type of thing. So, just one last few. What will you do? We have done both, frame-based and frameless also. But for this situation, for navigation-guided biopsies also is important because you have to go transcerebellar. If it was involving the midbrain, you could have come from above or thalamus. But in this, you will have to transgress. If you go from frontal standard, you have to come through the thalamus or the midbrain. So, that is not justified. So when you're doing a septatic biopsy through the posterior fossa, then navigation is helpful. Again, I think last one or two approach. This patient has been advised for consider that surgery is required to prove the diagnosis. So what approach will you use? What I thought was that the tumor is surfacing here. So this is simple, this follow this valicula, and this turned out to be a sort of peanut or something, and it was soft suckable tumor, most it was extraaxial, most of it came out. Okay, so approach, it looks like that you have to go like this, but if you are going like this, you will be transgressing all the nerves and going anterior to the nerves, and the aim is always do no harm. So surgical planning is used, it is surfacing here, and once you are into the tumor, you can go just keep on entering into the tumor. So this is a least minimally damaging approach. Again, this was just showing the what I told you before also, importance of veins. Not difficult to remove this tumor, but you may have to plan your craniotomy depending on the venous. MR venogram sometimes is helpful depending on that. So preserve also. Always, almost always in this location, you have one vein anterior, one vein posterior, sometimes in between also. A basal bifrontal craniotomy. You may, initially I used to include this orbital rims along with the craniotomy, but nowadays I stopped doing it. And the important thing is, in this what we were saying that day, this the all attachment is here. So before you open the door, devascularize it. Devascularize. And in this, you can remove this whole tumor without having to see or touch the brain. Just remain in the tumor. So this is very important. You can remove this tumor by any means. But removing this tumor without having to touch or retract the brain is the most important thing. This is again, orbitozygomatic or something like that. Approach. There are three approaches available for this. One is, you do a posterior petrosectomy, pre-sigmoid approach like this. Other is, you do a FTOZ, you do a subtemporal. Third is, you can go a retrosigmoid approach and like this. In this patient, I use a retrosigmoid approach. The nerves are split on both the sides and you can work between them. And it was total excision by a simple retrosigmoid approach. Why I showed this is, a retrosigmoid approach is one which is very good for these patients sometimes. You can avoid a lot of bony work. And you can extend the retrosigmoid approach if required, by doing a tentorial incision or from behind if it required a little bit of petrosectomy, anterior petrosectomy. So don't give up on retrosigmoid. This is an excellent approach and it can take care of so many lesions without doing a extended skull base work. Approach, I would do a Poppins rebound without seeing a venogram. Whatever veins are, they're displaced. Whatever veins are there, they're displaced. This tumor is no way enclosing. This is a meningioma, this is displacing all the veins. So whatever approach you go, you first see the tumor. So I went for this for a Poppins approach because it can give you exposure by cutting the tent from below and if required of the opposite side. Again, last approach. What I'm saying is I'm again emphasizing retrosigmoid approach is a good approach. Total removal by retrosigmoid approach. You see, this is called a lateral supracerebellar approach. You have to recover. And how do you tackle this tumor? This is cannot be seen by any angle from the retrosigmoid approach. So how do you tackle this? Always remember that the tentorial incision you give from this side can also be done from inferiorly also. You just cut the tent. You see the undersurface of temporal lobe and the medial part of temporal lobe. So again, emphasizing maybe it's an old thing, retrosigmoid approach is a good approach. Can be used without doing a pre-sigmoid or troposcopy in many of the cases. Same again, simple retrosigmoid approach. Huh? No need to, they're totally seen by simple retrosigmoid approach. I think that's all. Yeah.